And I'm going to introduce the next speaker, which is Alexis. And Alexis completed her undergraduate studies at UC Berkeley before gaining research experience on several labs, including the lab of Jeremy Reuters. And then she has joined for her PhD in Bruno lab, where she is doing some cool science, understanding the specification of cardiac precursor cells using single cell technologies. Her research is supported by NSF Graduate Research Fellow, UCSF Discovery Fellow, and AHS-CHF Pre-Doctoral Fellowships. And we are excited to hear her presentation. Alexis.
Thank you, Sutanzu. Let me get my presentation queued up here.
We're seeing your presenter mode.
Yeah, swap screens.
Thank you. I tried to get that set up so that wouldn't happen. How about now? Is that good?
Great.
Perfect.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you for the introduction. I'm Alexis. I've been in the Bruno lab for about 3 years now, and I'm going to be talking about my thesis research dissecting specification of cardiac precursor cells at single cell resolution. And so I'm opening here with this image of an embryo. I won't be talking about the story today, but this is actually the SMARCD3 F6 enhancer from Patrick's previous work that we have since chopped down to a much smaller region. This is about 200 base pairs that recapitulates the full activity of that enhancer. The embryo plays a big role in my research, and so I chose to open with this image. So the guiding question for my thesis is, I'm interested in what are the molecular mechanisms defining cell identities in space and in time? And I find it fascinating that we begin as a single fertilized zygote with the same set of genetic instructions. And then as we proceed through gastrulation to become what we can recognize here as a mouse embryo, all of those genetic instructions undergo changes in chromatin accessibility so that the cells of our different organ lineages can gain unique transcriptional identities. And the heart is an incredible sandbox when you ask these questions of specification of cell lineages, because it is the first embryo or the first organ of the embryo proper to form. And any errors in this process lead to congenital heart disease, which are very devastating and costly. And we lack a lot of interventions for them outside of surgery. And so from Benoit's 2008 Nature paper, I have this diagram listing all the different anatomies of the heart that can get disrupted when the genetic instructions of the cells meant to specify them are a little bit messed up. And so what's been challenging about studying these questions in the field prior is we use the mouse embryo because it highly capitulates what happens in the human. But the problem is that one of the classical tools, the MESP1 lineage, MESP1 is the first gene to turn on in the cells that are going to become the heart. But I hope, as you can appreciate from this image, whereas these MESP1 positive cells here, their lineage does not just include the heart, but all these other structures that are mesodermal derivatives. So to circumvent this, I was fortunate that Patrick and others prior to myself in the lab discovered this enhancer of SMARCD3 that marks the heart and all precursors of the heart at a very early stage within the MESP1 lineage. So for the first time, we have an innovation in the Bruno lab that allows us to track cardiac precursor cells within the developing mesoderm from early stages. And so we've built this into a mouse model, and I'm taking this sort of classical developmental biology approach, and I'm bringing it into the advent of the single cell transcriptomics era. And I'm very grateful for Benoit for taking a dev bio molecular cell biology grad student and letting her run wild with a computationally heavy project for her thesis. And so this project has been broken down into three parts. Part one is a wild type atlas study where I'm seeking to determine the specification and diversification of cardiac precursor cells emerging from the developing mesoderm. There's an abundance of literature now that points towards understanding that the heterogeneity of the different cell types that are going to occupy the various anatomies of the heart happens very early. And so now we have a tool that allows us to analyze those cells at single cell resolution early on. The second part of the study assesses how a loss of an early transcription factor, MESP1 here, alters the cardiac specification gene network. And then as the slide I opened with, we're also dissecting that SMARCD3 F6 enhancer as a way to understand the regulatory cues that are acting at the time of cardiac precursor cell specification. But I only have 12 minutes today, so I'm gonna focus on the perturbation study here and tell you the little vignette that's coming out of this. So what we've done here is we've knocked out MESP1, and what we found was that cardiac precursor cells endure, and they're noted here in this just pre-headfold cardiac crescent stage embryo. In the wild type embryo here, you can see the cardiac precursor cells in red. And in this mutant cell for MESP1, they're stuck in the back of the embryo here. This embryo is also a little bit malformed and somewhat developmentally delayed because it's missing some of the morphogenic milestones we would expect of an embryo of this stage. And so to get at this, like I was hinting at before, we've been using single cell RNA-seq. And so I've made a timeline of these early stage gastrulation embryos. It's a very tight time course. This was a lot of fun getting all these time points at various odd hours in lab. And we've done single cell transcriptomics from this data. And I've done the single cell analysis using the Seurat package in R. And the innovation we're bringing to this is that I've utilized all those transgenic reporters reporting on the mesoderm and the cardiac precursor cells to impart lineage relationships within the transcriptomic information. The next step was to look at developmental trajectories to understand the pseudotime ordering of cells to infer the basis of the mutant phenotype. And then we've also layered in single cell ATAC-seq analysis, which is a recent innovation made possible in part by 10x Genomics, but also the ability to analyze this data using the Archer-R package. So going into part one here, I was talking about the innovation we bring. Classically, if you were to study lineages, you might use FACS sorting to pull out the fluorescent reporters. But what I've done is I've just made a data set of the whole embryo. And so we have this timeline of about 96,000 cells spanning about E6 early gastrulation to just before the head fold stage at the cardiac crescent moment in development. And I've taken the entire embryo, all the different tissues. And then from this data set, I have included the ability to detect my fluorescent reporters so that I can look at where the MESP1 lineage and where the cardiac precursor cells are falling within the data. And then instead of doing a FACS sorting experiment, which is physiologically stressful for the embryos and their cells, I do this computationally. And I sort out the mesodermal cells I'm interested in looking in for cardiac precursor specification questions this way. The next thing that I've done is, you know, I alluded to these embryos looking developmentally delayed. And for those of us that study early embryogenesis, we know that the heart develops more as it moves around to the front of the embryo. Those cells act like a hug. And by the time you get to the anterior aspect of the embryo, those are more mature than the precursor cells that were at the back of the embryo. So based on the morphology of the cells, I thought that there was some developmental delay in these embryos. And so what I've done is I've applied pseudotime trajectory inference. One example I'm going to show here is using ERD. And I've taken that subset of the mesodermal cells from the full timeline. And I've looked at where the earliest embryos in that data set fall. And then within those early embryos, what's the most pluripotent cell type I could find reminiscent of the epiblast? And then wherever the oldest age embryos occupy, I set those as the tip of this trajectory. And then what ERD does is it assembles random walks going backwards from the tip to the root, and then it weights those walks to define the edges, and you get a trajectory like this. And in this diagram, I'm overlaying the ages of the embryos, and even though I didn't feed in embryo age, this trajectory correctly orders the oldest embryos purple at the tips and the younger embryos in the lighter yellow colors at the beginnings. And then what I've done is I've overlaid the genotypes. And so I looked at where my control and my MESP1 knockout embryos were falling. And then I looked at again where the cardiac precursor cell transgenic marker is. And then one of our favorite cardiac muscle genes, troponin T, to help me identify where the cardiomyocytes are falling in this trajectory. And the first thing I noticed was that the mutant cells do flow into these cardiomyocyte fate tips, but they appear appear distinct from the control cells. And so what I've done is I've done a series of differential gene expression analysis and followed up to validate a lot of these differentially expressed genes using RNAscope and C2s with the help of Sarah Winchester. And what we've determined is that loss of MESP1 leads to an aberrant expression of extraembryonic mesoderm gene program, but in cardiac precursor cells. And so why is this happening? And to get at this question of why is it happening, we've asked, do chromatin accessibility changes explain gene expression changes in these cells? MESP1 is a transcription factor. It's on very early. It appears not to be at the top of a hierarchy required for cardiogenesis, but it must have some role if we're getting these mixed up cell identities, and how? And so this brings us to the final part of this vignette, where I use single cell ataxic analysis of a complementary timeline of early gastrulation to answer this question. So the first thing I asked was, are any of the loci related to the cardiogenic gene program still accessible in these mutant embryos? And what I have here is a UMAP space of iterative latent semantic indexing to order the accessibility profiles of single cell ataxic into UMAP space. And what was striking is you can see the MESP1 knockouts in green and the various controls I included in this experiment in blue and red. And in the RNA-seq, we never see this strong of a spread between the two genotypes. So this was somewhat unexpected for me, having spent several months looking at the RNA-seq data, but there was actually not a batch here. This was real. And so the first thing I looked at was our favorite cardiac muscle gene, troponin T. We did have detection of troponin T in the mutant embryos, and I was curious if the accessibility profile was preserved in the mutants, which we did see as well. Then I looked at TBX5, a longtime favorite gene of the lab, which is also important when you're starting to partition morphogenesis of the heart and thinking about cardiac anatomy of the ventricle. And although we had barely any detection of TBX5 in our RNA-seq, we did have accessibility in the mutant cell types. And then this was fun. MESP1, the transcription factor we actually knocked out, has a highly accessible locus within the MESP1 knockout cells. And so this points to some hypothesis about an autoregulatory aspect that's lost when you lose the MESP1 transcript. But the important conclusion for our purposes today is that the accessibility for loci related to the cardiogenic program are preserved in MESP1 knockout embryos. And then the next step to understand what these cell types are as we're clustering them in our accessibility profiles of single cell ataxic, I went back to my RNA-seq and I carefully curated a complementary data set, and then I overlaid that to label the cell types in the UMAP space of the single cell ataxic. And what we're going through at this point is finding the comparable cell types in the knockout and the control, and we're comparing the differential accessibility of various loci and looking at how motifs are preserved or changed and what those can tell us related to what genes we're seeing preserved or changed in the context of the MESP1 knockout and RNA-seq. And so zooming out, this was, you know, the vignette of the perturbation study that fits into this larger framework of what I'm pursuing for my thesis, and hopefully puts a little drop in the bucket of understanding the molecular mechanisms defining cell identities in space and time. So with that, I'd like to thank the Bruno Lab and broader members of the UCSF and Gladstone community. Special thanks to Patrick, whose paper served as a huge inspiration for me kickstarting this project, and my funding sources. And I'd be happy to take questions. Thank you.
That was a nice talk, Alexis. Let me see if there are any questions. I would like to start asking questions. Do we have any evidence of MESP1's role in extraembryonic mesoderm that we already know of?
What was that?
MESP1's role in extraembryonic mesoderm?
MESP1's role in the extraembryonic mesoderm? Very little, I think. Most of the research focuses on its role in cardiogenesis. It's not strongly expressed in the extraembryonic mesoderm, unless someone wants to correct me on that. But we do have extraembryonic mesoderm in our wild type embryo data set, so I could query that in finer detail.
Okay, another question from Paul. It's an interesting finding. How widespread is the conservation of accessible chromatin in MESP1 mutants?
This is fresh data, Paul, but I have started looking at that, and it's quite widespread that we see a lot of accessibility in the MESP1 mutants. I'm presently trying to find genes that I think should be open but are closed. Another way that I want to do this is in a more unbiased manner, just looking at purely differential accessible loci and then trying to bin those into understanding different categories of genes related there. But it's not like the chromatin becomes more closed off. If anything, it's surprisingly open.
For the sake of time, I'll just take one question. That's from Jeff. And it says that, do you see an overrepresentation of cell types in your MESP1K embryos?
An overrepresentation of certain cell types. in the mesoderm, we see kind of a lot more signatures related to lateral plate mesoderm and kind of the earlier cell types that are part of the cardiac lineage. But I wouldn't say we see too many of them relative to what we would expect in the wild type. One thing that I haven't looked at as closely and I'm looking at now is if we have a, you know, too much endoderm, because in that knockout embryo I showed you, there's a very wide midline, and there's also like a very expanded anterior posterior axis of the endoderm. And I don't actually know, or the middle part of the embryo, and I don't actually know what those cells are. So I'm trying to figure that out to see if we've kind of misbalanced the cell populations in these embryos in that way.
I'm going to stop here, but thanks again. And there are some more questions from Heiko and Elfes. You might want to answer them on the chat or afterwards.
Thank you.
Thanks, Alexis.